Great sex at every age. Care to share?
Yes. I support that principle. I mean, come on, Gail. Okay. I mean, yes.
It's one of the panels.
What are you supposed to say to that?
I agree.
No, I take issue with great sex at every age. No.
I didn't know if you had some personal stories you wanted to share. Okay.
Yes, yeah. Gail. Okay. The answer is yes.
Sex during pregnancy is safe. True. Tell a friend. the change of the elasticity of the vagina. Sometimes it actually has to do with the change in the lubrication, because the hormones that have been released, especially somebody's breastfeeding, that can affect how much a person is lubricated. And so that is something that we should be in tune to know that when you have a baby in the initial postpartum period, not that you should be having sex right after having a baby, but thereafter, it can be different and it might require even a little bit more foreplay. True or false? You can change the strength of your orgasm.
True.
Yes. No, how would it say yes? You can. And how do you think anybody wants your thought? How do you think you can do that?
Who said?
Was that what you want to say?
True.
Think right? Y'all know. And you don't think that that's the case sometimes, but orgasms, part of the orgasm-like experience is a contraction of the pelvic floor muscles. And if those muscles aren't very strong, that orgasm can fade and not be very strong. Some ways to actually improve that are with Kegel exercises. How many people think that they even know how to do a Kegel? Like, how do you do it? You know how to do it. How many people can tell me how often you should do it? Around, there will never be a door. And you can squeeze your knees 10 times. I'm doing right now, Giselle. Cause auntie is not getting pregnant, so she like, let's just do the thing, you know? We need and you don't know when they were screened or who they were with the last time they were screened or how they were screened. There are a plethora of STDs and STIs a person can get with or without symptoms, by the way. Do you know that you can get infections even if you have no symptoms? So it's important that we are screened and tested at all, again, ages and stages in our lives. Who have a propensity toward yeast infections or just having irritation with exposure to new products, that's something that can help protect the skin. And olive oil is also a very inert oil, so it doesn't have, like, I love lavender oil, I love different types of, like, essential oils, but some of them can be a little aggressive for our skin. So it's good to have, like, an extra virgin olive oil that you use just for the area. Don't get double dipping in the kitchen. I know how you do it. Don't do that. We have what we call symptomatic fibroids, which has to do with them having causing heavy bleeding or pain. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of science as to why that is. Some of it's genetic. We know that there's generations of us with them, but why? One thing that we do know that we can connect fibroids with is actually increased weight. So those of us who may be carrying more weight, there is more estrogen in circulating, and the fibroids do feed off of that. So if we can keep our weight under control, we can have hopefully less growth and thus less symptomatic fibroids. These certain types of birth control can stabilize them. Some of them don't necessarily do that, but some do. So if we're talking to your doctor, if you are somebody who struggles with recurrent fibroid, you keep having to have them removed or treated. And there are treatments for them that are some surgical and some non-surgical. But unfortunately, I wish we had more real insight into what we can do to treat them. There are a lot of remedies if you Google it, but a lot of them don't have scientific, foundations. So it's hard to speak to that. Sometimes a harvest product can be irritating, or a travel product. We're all here for essence, some of us don't live here, and you're in a hotel using new soap. I bring my soap with me everywhere, because I can't afford to be out here irritated, you know what I'm saying? Which, how you gonna call us when we standing here living, all uncomfortable? That's not you at all. So I have to bring my product. So, but the partner also, you might have a partner that needs to shower off that Axe body spray. He smells good, but get that away from my vagina. Because I could potentially be irritated as a result of the other person's products. That's why. So anal sex is something that we should definitely address. Condom use is key because the anus is actually much more susceptible and receptive to STDs than the vagina is because of all of the mucous membranes that are down there. There's just a lot more open space to receive an infection, unfortunately. And so what we need to do is two things: condom use and more lubrication. Because the vagina also releases more, like, its own endogenous, like, gland release is lubrication, is, sexual arousal. But the anus doesn't have that. The anus does not have those same glands that release those lubricating factors. And so there's more likely to have tears, small tears in the anus, again, increasing our risk for infection. So be very careful. People can get not only, regular traditional chlamydia, gonorrhea type stuff, but even HPV. HPV is very common just in the population, and that can lead to, unfortunately, to anal cancer. So just keep in mind that you need to protect your anus even more than your gut. You protect them both, but that is very important, like extremely important from a protection standpoint. It's a great one, because it's out of size, so we need to be clean, right? So cleaning the vagina, staying clean, cleanse. I think outside hair bearing areas, whether or not you have hair there, like if you, wax or shave, but with hair women, you can use a mild soap. And that's where I bring in my Dove, or I have this one African black soap that it doesn't irritate me, because not all black soaps are good for me either. But on the outside, you can use that to clean. Anything between the labia, you see my between, because I just like the visual, between the labia, anything that is like the slippery area, does not need soap, should not have soap, water only. Don't put anything else in there. Water only, because that will change your pH and that will throw off sometimes the bacteria that should be there, the normal bacteria that can, and the abnormal bacteria can overgrow and cause a bacterial vaginosis or yeast. Now, what I do like for the vagina, douche is a four-letter word for gynecologists, right? Don't even think swallow. But it is a pill, it's in pill form, and you can put it in the vagina. And actually, one of the sponsors for that is Walmart, they sell it. They sell it in their pharmacy area, it's not a prescription. If you put it in the vagina, it actually dissolves, and it does not absorb into your system, which is why you don't die. It's okay to do that. It doesn't absorb, the molecules are too big. But it re-acidifies the vagina. The vagina is supposed to be acid. It's supposed to be more acidic than basic, if anybody remembers chemistry, more acidic than basic. If it shifts to be more basic or more middle of the ground, that's when bacterial vaginosis and yeast can form. That's when the irritation can happen. It can actually increase your risk for sexually transmitted infections because that inflammatory kind of tissue is, or inflamed tissue is more receptive and it's more, it's less barrier, less of a barrier in the vagina. But if you can keep that area more acidic, lactobacillus is the bacteria that our vagina lacks. Lactobacillus acidophilus is the name of it. Lactobacillus acidophilus. So you put more gas in the vagina when you feel uncomfortable, or even when you start to feel uncomfortable, and it can shift the good bacteria into the dominant and shift the bad bacteria into the less dominant, or into the, you know, keep it at bay, essentially. So that's something I keep in my drawer, my medicine cabinet. In my drawer, in my bathroom. If I feel a little off, but when I'm in the vagina overnight, and it can reset you. You can do it one, two nights in a row. You should not have oral sex. You can even probably avoid regular, like, penetrative sex during that time. But if you do use condoms because you just don't want, like, it's like a powder. When it kind of comes out, it's like a powdery discharge. But it really, I mean, my patients love it. I love it. It's something to really keep in mind. I get it on Amazon. I told you Walmart has it. But it's a more natural way to keep the vagina clean, if you will. But you don't need that. Let me be clear about this. You don't need that for your vagina to just be clean. The vagina is what we call a self-cleaning oven, right? It's a self-cleaning oven. It does not need a refresher even after your period. It will cleanse itself. But it's something that if you feel a little off, try that before it gets so bad that you have to get your prescription from your gynecologist. I love to see you, but you can fix some of this stuff yourself. You know what I mean?